same body.
Yep. And there is also such a scheme in the lecture slides showing how to connect two four-bit adders to build up an 8-bit adder. Actually, all remains disconnected apart from the carry bit. Carry bit has to go to the next one. It brings you 5 more points. We are already at 20 points.
Mm-hmm. Hopefully. Halfway to B.
Okay, shift registers. You can get such questions to work out a shift register in a particular case. So you are given a group of bits, whatever it is, 1010, 0110. It's serially shifted, leftmost bit first. So this is coming into the register, into an 8-bit parallel output shift register. You see it's 8-bit, there are 8 flip-flops in the register. It's a parallel output, apparently serially, because we are streaming the bits serially in the register. And it already has a content. Initial state is this. What is the register's content after each of the first 3 clock pulses? So remember, shift register, after 1 clock pulse, it's shifting the content leftwise or rightwise. So 3 clock pulses means that it will happen 3 times. Each time there will be an input coming from outside. Okay, this is my initial state.
Yeah.
Shifting.
It's taking set.
Okay, left most. It means I'm shifting left. So what's happening? I am shifting the whole content to this direction. This one will go to the second place. This is going to the third place, etc. This zero will be lost because it's going outside. What is coming to the first position? It's actually the first bit from outside. So this is the content of the register after 1 clock. The second time, I'm shifting again. So this one is coming here, this one is coming here, etc. This zero is getting lost. The next bit is coming. That's coming here is the next bit from this serial input. And the third clock pulse, I'm again shifting everything to the left direction. This zero is lost, and what's coming here is this bit, third one. Okay.
Sorry, sir. So in the exam, are we going to draw the arrows?
Well, you can if you want to make it comprehensive, but that's not something I would.
Or you can write 2 lines to exchange
just the numbers.
You can write just the numbers. For me, it was easier actually to track how the bits are moving. Don't make mistake. All right. Again, repetition from the lecture notes. Schematic diagrams of JK and the flops, the flops, and show truth tables.
This is common.
JK and D flip.
And show how you can actually. This is an extra question. How can you make E flip-flop using the JK flip-flop?
This should be at least like 10 marks or more because it's two
so
questions.
You're not getting both questions at the same time. This is just a collection of questions. So they are simpler. So JK flip-flop, it's repetition of the lecture notes. I shouldn't even mark you for that because we have done it so many times in the last month, so everybody knows it. B flip-flop the same. I don't have an answer to the truth tables, check the ledger notes. But how can we make a D flip-flop from a JK flip-flop? Okay, I think there was such a solution in the ledger notes. If not, you make truth tables and then you actually combine the inputs. There is actually such a solution. So the aim is to invert the K input to prevent that. Actually, to ensure that whatever is coming to B, it will be set or reset mode. It's never toggle, it's never retain the state. It's always set or reset. Okay? apart from recording me, you also have to understand it, because you can't bring your mobile phone to the exam. So I hope you will use it wisely,
yes,
not
sir.
Only for purpose of recording.
Yes, sir.
Right. Seventh question I showed here is about a little bit of signal processing. One of these last lectures, I think question 9 or so, maybe wrong now. What is the minimal sampling frequency to accurately reconstruct the sampled signal with maximum frequency at 30 kHz? Nyquist frequency, that's what we have. We
have minus f/2, then f/2 fraction.
What you are saying now is actually how you sketch spectrum.
Yeah.
But it's not that.
Yeah.
So not yet. No. The answer is no. Nyquist frequency is connected to the maximum frequency signal in a way that the Nyquist frequency has to be double.
That's 2 times 30.
The maximal signal. So if it's 30 kHz, the maximal frequency, the Nyquist frequency would be 60 kHz. It can also be asked the other way around. It can be given the Nyquist frequency, compute the maximal frequency, it would be half.
Yeah.
So if I say Nyquist frequency is 60 kHz, what is the maximum frequency of the signal? 30 kHz, because it's half.
So the minimum is like we times it by 2. The maximum is...
it's called Nyquist frequency. The minimal sampling frequency is the Nyquist frequency, and that's double the maximum frequency in the signal. If the maximum signal frequency is 30 kHz, Nyquist frequency is 60 kHz. If I ask you the other way around, I give you a Nyquist frequency, then the question would be what is the maximum signal frequency? It's a half of it. So Nyquist frequency is always larger than the maximum signal frequency. So keep that in mind when you are answering. And the last short question about AD conversion and DA conversion. How does reconstruction accuracy? Analog signal up something, change the number of quantization levels. Accuracy is becoming better, so accuracy is growing with more quantization levels, is the answer. And then, if you remember, one of the pages in that ADVA conversion was talking about accuracy and precision. So maximal error, actually, and accuracy. If you have a uniform quantizer, compute the ratio between the maximum quantization errors for 8 and 10 bits. So AD converter is determined by the number of bits. We have two quantizers here. One is using 8 bits, the other is using 10 bits. What is the ratio between the maximal the maximal quantization errors in these two cases? So number of quantization levels is equal to the power of 2, where n is the number of bits. Quantization interval is the whole interval divided by that. Maximum quantization error is a half of the interval. So delta half. And since I have 2 to the power n, if I divide something by 2, that would mean 2 to the power n plus 1. Okay, now n is the number of bits. In the case with 8 bits, I have epsilon with 8. It would mean that I put 8 here, so I would have 2 to the power 9. In case with 10 bits, I would have 2 to the power 11. Actually, the ratio between these two would mean that I'm just dividing 2 to the power 11 with 2 to the power 9. If you know division, I hope you know, all the exponentials. This is 2 to the power of difference between these two.
11
minus 9, which is 2. 2 to the power 2 is 4. So the answer to this question is 4. Error in the case of more expensive 10-bit quantizer is 4 times smaller than that in the case of cheaper quantizer with 8 bits. Okay. Actually, 8 short questions. However, only 4 will appear, not on these different questions, but basically from the same style, the same content, pretty much compressing the same content in lectures. 4 will appear in the exam, the other 4 are coming from analog electronics. So if you focus on short questions in digital electronics, you can earn up to 20 points. still far away from us. We need more.
Can we compromise your professional integrity by paying the quiz discussion?
Sorry, what?
So he's trying to bribe you.
No, you can't. This is called revision, so that's what I'm doing.
Let's compromise your